they call Boone the Boulder of the Appalachians. The first mover, please.
All right, good morning, Onsby. You're collaborating with the musicians, looking at them. That's great. Love to hear a little bit more intent behind the preparatory and see more intent within your preparatory gestures. Perhaps in an effort to be smaller over with your gesture, we're not getting as much of the meaning. In other words, exactly how do you feel about the music? What are the decisions you made interpretively? I also encourage you to stand up upright more. Different. And when you know the music is supposed to, it has a different intent behind it. We need to look differently.
Nice going, Onsby. Good. Let's go back to the beginning now. Okay. Now, tell us, so you've had a lot of experience.
Well, varying different experiences.
I
taught public school for a couple years before coming back to school, and then I was a trombonist about half of my 11 years, and then a conductor and various other jobs the other half.
In the Marines.
In the Marine Corps.
Okay. So, that being said, there's just a couple of technical things I want you to think about. One is just the way you hold the baton, the grip. So tell me what if you were teaching a conducting class and you were teaching someone how to hold the baton, what would you tell them?
I normally have them open their hand, place it in, and just have them relax.
Right. That's exactly right.
Okay.
Now, I don't think that's what you do, actually, when you're conducting, because it you tend to bring your fingers up, and what you're doing is sort of a lot of rotation here. And I like to teach a wrist-oriented conducting technique so that things are moving, the wrist is pliable, and so you're generating a lot of, it doesn't even matter whether it's staccato or whether it's legato, but especially in legato music, that the wrist is the first thing that's moving, and the baton is coming behind it. And I generally advise people to keep your palm toward the floor. I don't know, 93.6% of the time, something like that. I mean, there's a lot more this way. You tend to do that a lot.
Okay.
And what's interesting is it almost creates a situation where the tip of the baton isn't working for you because it's stationary almost, but it's almost like this is what's going on. You know, you're conducting back here, and the baton is really staying in the same place if you analyze it. Watch it on the video and see if you agree with that.
Okay.
But I would just love you to keep your palm down and utilize this space a little bit more rather than turning it so much. Okay, can we just go from the beginning now? Do you like this piece?
I do.
Okay. Because I don't think that we knew that.
Okay.
Because it's not that you disliked it, but we just didn't see that that the charm of it appealed to you very much. So you've got to let us in on that, you know. And the moments that you find special, I think you should share that with the group.
Okay.
Okay, so let's go back to the beginning now. Talk about just those moments for a moment. I know we keep coming back to this in various people, but here's what I don't want them to know exactly what we're talking about, because I want you to go back and do it and sort of show this. But what we don't get here, I think, is this, then these things right where we arrived here, being in proportion.
Okay.
They seem like they're disjunct sort of moments that only deal with that specific thing and not this and then this.
So more horizontally rather than vertically.
Yeah, and then I think this has to be prepared.
Okay.
You know? So anyway, why don't we just start here at 17 with the oboe and then we'll go let it build from here and we'll see if you can. It's very difficult to figure out a different fingering on the spot for this, but that's in a way what I'm asking you to do. Just like Dr. McKinney was talking about earlier, for all of these things, we have to have at least 10 ways to do something, you know, so that when it doesn't work and you think, okay, well, I wasn't effective that time, so I'm going to try it a different way, rather than just being stuck in the same way. You've got to have a bunch of different conducting fingerings to pull out of the bag.
Okay.
So let's try that. Good. There's a couple of things. Now, first thing is that was great because it was different.
Right.
I don't even know if that's what you wanted, but it's just great that you were able to make a couple of subtle changes there. I think that's really good. Now, when we get to this music here, again, I don't want them to know exactly what we're talking about, but what is it that you want to hear? Because it seems like you're layering a lot of attention on this
on
material
those, yeah.
rather than on this.
I want a restatement of you. Really to mimic what happened at the entrance.
Right. And I think that this is where you're lavishing all of your attention.
Okay.
So I think maybe, why don't you reverse that?
Okay.
There's a rule. We'll talk about this more, I'm sure, over the next couple of days. But when you have sustained music and at the same time, when we do Lincolnshire Posey, this comes up. When you have sustained music versus active music and they're both going on at the same time. Mm-hmm. Bar 82 of the last movement of Lincolnshire Posey. You know, so what you always do is you always conduct the long music, but you listen to this music.
Gotcha.
But you don't do it the other way around.
Okay.
So you don't conduct this music and listen. You know, you have to do it this way. You conduct the line here, but the whole time, but you're listening to that sequence that's going on. Okay, so can we just do this again from 17? Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Now conduct these guys. Good, now set this up. Good, now, good, thank you, excellent. Okay, good. I want you to describe, what is the quality of sound that you want to have?
I'd really like it to be deeper and darker.
Okay.
The words that come to mind.
Okay, so how do you do that? What will they have to do in order to make that happen?
Open up?
Well, not in a technical sense for them, but there has to be some sort of adjustment then to that. So you have to send a signal to them, because right now they're playing and you seem happy and everybody's great. But if you want more bassoon, more of the low guys, then you'll have to give them a little extra goose there. Or maybe the issue is it's less horns that we need. Yeah. So I don't know. Those are instinctive things that you have to do on the spot, but it's not always asking for more of something. Sometimes it's taking away something that will help get the sound that you want. So let's do it again. 17.
Okay. 17.
Composers are really bad, by the way, when they write a piece about always wanting to hear more of this. You know, because I wrote this and I can't hear it, so can I bring this out a little bit more? Now I can't hear this over here, so bring this out a little bit more, because they want to hear what they wrote, but not realizing that what would help everything is to just bring it all down a little bit and then let that one line come out. So we've got to not be guilty of that as well. Okay, so here we go. 17 again. Good. Now here we go.
It's interesting that you wanted that to be deeper and darker, yet you looked at the horns and they gave you more. Say though, I really appreciate how I'm seeing more of the prioritization of what's important to you at any given time.
Excellent. Good. Now, what would happen if you just let her play that and didn't mess with her at all on it?
It'd probably be better.
Well, I don't know, but I don't think she needs the help right there. Yeah, absolutely. Because what if maybe she wants to do just a little something right here?
Right.
Why don't we just see what would happen there? Let's start on bum zee, za ba bim, ba ba bim, that sequence.
34.
Yes, thank you. Let it go. Good. Here's the deal. What you don't want to do is be controlling.
Right.
You know, you want to let them play, you know, let them have the chance to do that every once in a while. I can remember the words of Gustav Meyer coming back into my head, and so I'm going to the fetal position. When I think about it, Jari, you don't trust your players. And I would think, of course I do. That's, you know, old man, you know.
Right.
And then I would watch the video and I'd think, you know, he's right about that. So I was doing more than I needed to and more than I thought that I was too. Mm-hmm. So in moments like that, just let them play. Now let's do the end. We're gonna skip all the way to the end. Because nobody's doing this correctly. Can we just take it from the pick up the 214? Okay, now here, tell me, let's talk about the last 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 bars. What is the dynamic here?
Piano.
Right. And then this?
Forzando.
Right. And then?
Piano again.
And see, it seems to me that this never recovers from this.
Okay.
So I think the conductor is needed here at the end to make, because it's so special, these last 5 bars. If we can really do this, and then all of a sudden this is, you know. So can you just try that? Again, we're not, hopefully they're not,
so
they don't
right
know what
227?
We're talking about. No, let's don't do it there. Let's go back and do the whole thing again so we can set that up and then we'll be done. Now watch Onsby. Yeah, here's what I would love, is if you put more emphasis on this. You sort of put more on this. Yeah, so I think we need to flip that around.
Okay.
Okay. No, we're out of time, unfortunately, so we'll save that for another time.
Great.
Okay, nice going, Onsby.
Onsby, go back and watch when you started that section the first time and when Jerry was conducting along with you. Not that you have the same interpretation, but watch how he was communicating his intent differently than you were yours. Good job.